Hello all, welcome to Athletics LLC. We're here for another week of exciting, thought-provoking, fighting questions. We are joined by a special guest, so we are all excited for this conversation to take part in. But tonight we are joined by Lamar Kingdom Skeets Johnson. I had to slow down. We've got Clyde. We've got Lucius. And then
good evening.
The all-time great Alan Johnson.
Hello.
USA. USA.
You have no fans whatsoever on this show. None at all. So we are going to dive right into it and just get juicy off tops. Starting the hurdles. 8-step versus 7 steps. Go.
Who's going first?
Oh, you are.
Oh, you are definitely going
first. Okay.
I feel bad because I told you I wasn't going to go first.
Okay.
Well. I can go first. I mean, I'm not scared.
I'm deferring to you.
You want me to go first?
Sure.
You always defer to me because I'm the old guy. I know. All right. So the first thing I'm going to say is I think that the 7 steps has changed the game greatly for the good and for the bad. And it's not like 7 steps is not a new thing. Like back in the 70s when I was running hurdles, like people were taking 7 steps and some did it effectively. And it became a thing when people started running fast doing 7 steps. And so once somebody did well with the 7 steps, and all of a sudden it became the new fad. It became the thing that everybody felt they had to do. And I don't personally believe the 7 steps is for everyone. I think you have special athletes that can do it. The argument is that when you're taking 8, there's a deceleration into the hurdle, which I can't totally disagree with. But if you're taking 7 and you're reaching, you have no acceleration whatsoever into the hurdle. So for me, I'd rather have a guy that's a little shorter with a better acceleration cut up in his last 2 steps at the first hurdle to maintain momentum than to be reaching to take 7. And I just think that too many people think that because you're taking one less step, that that's the answer, and then everybody's going to run crazy fast because they take 7 steps.
I mean, I would have to agree with that. I think the 7 steps is, in a lot of cases, overrated. Again, like you said, I think too many people think that if somebody runs fast with 7 steps, and they're like, okay, I'm going to do 7 steps and I'm going to run faster. The problem is, who's strong enough to cover the distance effectively? You know, yes. I've seen a lot of athletes cover the distance, 7 steps of the first hurdle, but not effectively. And you're overstriding, you're reaching, you're taking off too far away from the hurdle, or a combination of all those things. And then you end up not carrying enough speed through the first hurdle to effectively run the race as fast as that person possibly can. And then 8 steps, you can get jammed and be too close to the hurdle. So it depends on the person. I tried to do 7 steps one time in practice. I didn't feel comfortable with it. So, I mean, obviously I stayed with 8. But I think like Coach said, it depends on the individual. And how strong that individual is. And my question that I have also with the 7 steps is the fatigue factor. Like what do you do with an athlete? Say you're at practice, you're doing 7, 7, 7, you're doing a lot of reps, and they get to the point where they're starting to fatigue. So obviously they're not as strong at that point. They're not covering as much ground. And how does that affect everything? Because I would imagine that it would kind of throw things off a little bit.
There's no doubt about that. I mean, I think that, and that's something people, I like to choreograph everything we do. And we spend a lot of time, you know, choreographing 7 steps or choreographing 8 steps. And if you've got an athlete that's struggling to take 7, in my opinion, all you're doing is creating bad habits, which are going to take them to the meet. And as we all know, once they go to the meet and they run bad, now you got a whole different set of problems.
Yeah.
I would agree.
Sorry, go ahead.
No, you go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to say, I mean, just to me, the whole thing about getting to the first hurdle, whether seven or eight, is how much momentum can you carry through the first hurdle?
Amen. Absolutely.
And to add to that, I've played around with this both as an athlete for a very short period of time and as a coach. First and foremost, the women should not try this, in my opinion. There's been very, very few that can pull it off at all. Mm-hmm. It's extremely inconsistent, regardless of the gender. And for me, unless you can do it consistently and maintain a better velocity with it, I say, you know, you shouldn't even bother trying it. It requires an insane amount of explosive power. And for me, when I played around with it with some of my athletes, what my benchmark has been, as Alan just said, velocity through number one. But for me, the real benchmark is, are you gaining, keeping, or losing velocity at hurdle three? I've seen enough people be able to match or slightly increase the velocity at one, but the work that they had to put in to do it and the inconsistency always showed up at number three. And so that's usually how I take a look at it when I do have men that I want to, you know, see if that's going to work. But I think I agree with Lucius, that a lot of people saw Merritt do it and break a world record, and therefore, oh, that's the new thing. And we all know that our sport is very copycat oriented on many levels, mm-hmm. without people taking the studious approach and understanding the background behind these decisions that are made. For me, I'm 6'3", and I was powerful enough to do it, but I didn't have anybody teaching it to me effectively. I was trying to do it myself, and I was way too inconsistent. So I just threw it out because I didn't know any better. I think if you're, you know, 6'2" or better, and you're really explosive, you got a shot at it.
See, I'm gonna borrow my man Lamar's thing. I'm gonna be a little contrary for you for a second. One, I'm gonna say to you that if they're creating more momentum through hurdle one, and then at hurdle three there's a problem, then they did something totally jacked up between one and two and two and three.
Very possible.
I don't know how you create more momentum if you're reaching all the stuff people do to take seven. I think, again, like the thing, the biggest issue for me is, like, people think, okay, because somebody is tall, like, they can do it. But, like, we have people that are, like, I'll take Hakeem Sonny Brown. Hakeem Sonny Brown is 6'2 and some change, but it's all upper body, you know, so his stride length is not that great. You know, a guy like Grant is all legs, so it's a lot easier for a guy like Grant to take it. So Grant, it's not about even Grant's power output. It's the fact that he has these long limbs, and it's a natural stride rhythm for him, you know. So I think that that's something that people have to take into consideration. The other thing is, too, it goes back way beyond Merritt. It goes back to David Oliver, you know, and people like that, you know. And the thing was, like, all of a sudden women were doing it. And the only woman I've seen do it effectively – two of them, actually. Jackie Joyner Kersee and Sharika Nelvis. The only two I've ever seen that effective. Not that I paid that close attention, but those are the two. And I think in both of their cases, we know Jackie has extremely long limbs, and so does Sharika.
I'm not disagreeing with that, and I'm not suggesting that Aries was the benchmark. I'm saying that when Aries did it and then broke a world record doing it, that's when the fad really took off. David was doing it before him, no doubt, but nobody was trying to copy David.
And I'm telling you, I disagree. It happened before then. The fad was coming because Aries was part of the fad, in my opinion.
Yes, I agree.
Yeah. So he didn't recreate
it. Jason Richardson was doing it too.
Right.
If I'm not mistaken, Liu Shang did seven steps. I can't remember if he did it before or after he broke the world record.
Robles did it?
Yes, Robles did it. He did it very well.
Yeah, he did?
Yeah, Robles, definitely.
I wish that my coach would have listened to me, because I'm a very powerful and dynamic starter to the point where I'm as explosive as a wet napkin now. So, but I couldn't use my my 100 meter start in the 110 hurdles. Cause I couldn't pick my knees up to get through the hurdle. So like I was a lot like Grant. Like if my coach had let me seven, cause I could start with either leg forward. If he'd have let me seven, he would have never, ever had me do eight. If he let me seven one time, because I did it one time playing around and I was like, man, that's easy. They make it seem like it's hard. I would have been able to just, I was like, so if I could just push as hard as I want, I'm good. And I could have just like never had to learn two different block starts. And like, I mean, it was like a foot difference between my pedals in this, you know, for 100 and it was for a 110. But, you know, back in my day and AJ's day of running, like there were very few coaches that even thought that was anything other than junk science. And they thought you had to be like freakishly tall to do these things. And is it like, you know, and my coach was an athlete coach too. So like, clearly, you know, making a change and it might be we might go backwards before we go forwards. And that, look, if I had ran one race from seven, I probably had dropped like 3 or 4 tenths because I could have run through the first hurdle. I always had to basically survive the first hurdle and then run because I couldn't really push as hard as I could and run because I was going to run up on top of the first hurdle. So I definitely think I champion all three of you guys' points in that I think that it's a trochanter length issue. It's a natural tendon strength issue. Like if you watch Grant do it, it doesn't look like if you just listen, it sounds like eight. You know what I mean? Like mm-hmm. They're not long. Like there's no air time. It's like pop, 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 pop. Right? It sounds like eight. If you can have, if you have an athlete who can make seven sound like eight, then they should run seven. But if seven sounds like, you know, seven mini bounds, it's the wrong thing for them.
I heard you give a great answer to this question one time when someone was asking, because you were a person that said that you used to run up on the hurdle and you ended up with a very creative way to fix that problem coming out of the blocks. How did you tackle that issue?
Well, first, I've in my time running, I felt in with the whole 7 and 8 step thing, I concluded that the distance is ideal for 7.5 steps. So what I did was, so that I could attempt to run through the hurdle as fast as I could, I cut my steps in the beginning off the blocks. And so I sacrificed a little bit off the blocks, went a little short to put myself back to then run through the first hurdle. So
that's ostensibly what I had to do too.
Yeah.
So you choreographed your run.
Yeah, exactly.
So I think that that's as part of the reason why I was always a big fan, because my young guys, when I'm showing them videos of you and some of the other greats, the one thing about you was you looked the same every time. If you ran 12, sub 13, if you ran 13.2, it looked the same. And I think that was the greatness of Alan Johnson. And I think that that's something that if you're an aspiring young hurdler, that you need to try to master and understand that, like, this is about consistency. And that was something that I'm glad sure. Clyde asked that question, because that's huge, man. That's huge.
For sure.
Well,
the thing is to be able to just do the same thing over and over and over mm-hmm. again. And so that I believe that you have to do it so much that your bad days really aren't that bad. So the more you do it, the more consistent you get with it. And like you said, Coach, you choreograph your run, especially in the hurdles, because it's the only race on the track where every step is going to come down within, I'm going to say, a few inches of any other step, of any other race for that step. I don't know if mm-hmm. I said that clearly, but the steps are going to always be in the same place for all 51 steps or 50 steps every time you run. You're going to have headwinds, you're going to have tailwinds, you're going to have perfectly still day, and those steps still have to be in the same spot.
And that's the problem with the people who are doing seven that shouldn't be doing seven. The bad days are never almost as good as the good days. The bad days are like emergency abort bad days, and then it just goes really bad really fast, and that's the biggest problem. There's very few people who've done 7.
Yeah.
Well, so talking about choreographing and navigating a little bit, let's talk about some competition. So in the coming years, the next 5-year cycle, we've got major championships every year. How are we going to navigate this as coaches? And then how are we going to have, or how should we see the athletes navigate this as well?
Coach?
I was going to say Lucius. This is all you, buddy.
Okay. Well, you know, the first thing I'm going to tell you, I'm going to coach my athletes. And I think that people are making too big of a deal out of it. And the bigger deal you make out of it, the more stress it's going to cause. We have athletes to get ready, and people are going to say it's not the same. I'm going to disagree. We have athletes to get ready for the NCAA championships every year. So as a coach, you know, I've been coaching at the university. I just finished my 25th season here. So I've been getting athletes ready for the NCAA championships for 25 straight years. So if you're smart enough and you have a plan, just stick to your plan, and I think you'll be fine. But if you make a huge deal out of it, okay, then it's going to be a problem. You know, there's no doubt. Now, we have to run, be a little smarter, maybe not run as many diamond leagues and stuff like that. Of course you might. We may have to, you know, after the third year, maybe give them a little more rest or spend a little more time in your fall base or whatever that. Absolutely. But the thing is like, instead of, you know, everybody, oh my God, we got 5 measures in a row, sit your behind down and figure out what you got to do and get it done. I'm going to go my man Clyde on this one. I don't want to hear that mess. You know, do your job.
I agree with you 100%. I think it's a good thing. Like you say, in college, there's an NCAA championship every single year. Name a sport where there's not a championship every single year. Which two?
Indoor.
What's that?
There's two championships every year.
Two championships every year. And my thing is, at what point does an athlete train for a year and they're not trying to run as fast as they can that year? So my thing is, you're trying to run as fast as you can every single year. You're training to run as fast as you can every single year. It just so happens that for the next 5 years, every year that you're trying to run as fast as you can, you get the opportunity to do it at a meet that's called the World Championships or Olympics. And there are going to be a bunch of other people there trying to do the same thing.
Clyde, Lamar.
I love you both, but I think you're both drunk and high at the same time. I think 5 major championships in a row is not even remotely similar to anything that we've ever done. I think, you know,
that's a reason not to do it.
No, I didn't say not to do it. I've never said that. What I'm saying is, look, here's what I'm saying. If I was from Mingo, I would feel like I'm about to kill everybody. Because my coach, meaning you, has this sewed up. But there are a great number of very talented people who are not in those systems. And they're going to have to change coach from college coach to somebody else, right? Well, you can't go back. There's always an ideal time to do that, quote unquote, the off year. Well, now you're doing that in a championship year. And if your money is dependent on how you do at championships, that is relevant. So I understand what you're saying because you have been at the same place for 20 years. You got it all locked up, and all of your kids are going to stay with you. What I'm saying is there is a real live issue that has to be dealt with. I'm not saying we're not going to get through it. I'm not going to say, oh, my God, one of these championships is going to be terrible. But what I'm saying is that there's a great number of people in our sport that don't plan. They just do things year to year. And I will tell you, if you don't have this, if you don't have the 5-year plan put together, if you don't have a thought process as to how you're going to do things slightly differently or make adjustments from year to year, or what do you do if after 3 years of competing at that high level, your athlete is super duper tired. If you don't have a plan mentally, somebody is being set up for true and utter failure. That's all I'm saying. That's all I'm saying.
So
I'm not gonna.
Before Clyde goes, I'd like to make a comment before you go, Clyde. I have no freaking idea what you're talking about. Because you went around the block to cross the daggum street again. Okay? You accuse my man AJ and I of being on drugs or something. And you disagreed us, we're high. And basically you argued our argument in the middle of your argument. As my man Clyde would say, in the middle of your rant. Okay.
Not at all.
For every one coach that doesn't get it, there's four or five that do. Okay. There's four or five that do. So
get out of here.
I'm gonna peace out with you on that one. Clyde, handle your business, dog. I ain't hear nothing. Go ahead, Clyde.
Okay. So I'm actually gonna take a slightly nuanced approach to. I'm gonna be in the middle of all of this. I agree with all of you in different.
We are respects. So surprised.
No, okay. I'm serious. Listen. The fact of the matter is that a lot of people, and by people I mean coaches, the people who are directing these fabulous talents, a lot of people do not adjust well to unknown circumstances, and so I think. The nuances that we are about to face are going to end up exposing a lot of people and therefore could potentially end some careers prematurely. Now, do I think it has to be that way? Absolutely not. Do I want to hear the excuses? Absolutely not. At the end of the day, professionals are professionals. And unfortunately in our sport, professional track and field is kind of still very much a Hunger Games situation. So you're going to have a lot of people, both the people who are good financially, they're going to be out there doing what they need to do and they can pick their spots. But it's that second tier. It's those people who are dependent on the races, dependent on making the teams to keep their checks rolling in. They're the ones that are ultimately going to suffer and be in trouble and make weird decisions. And if they're in a situation that their coach or the people directing their careers don't know how to handle, oh, it's going to be a problem for a bunch of people. Now, should it be? No. And I don't have any sympathy for those that do. But it is what it is. And, again, our sport does not usually handle massive sweeping changes well in the short term. And so I'm very interested to see how this plays out.
So this is what I'm going to say to you is that, you know, we're back on this tier thing again, okay? And the number of those second-tier people that are on the dominant side of it is minuscule, okay? So most of the people that are the medal winners and are the torch carriers, they're fine. They have contracts, okay? And if somebody that's in the second tier gets into the first tier, guess what? They get a contract, and they'll be fine,
mm-hmm.
You know? So, like, so my thing is, like, we have to quit looking at the doom and gloom side of this. And as AJ, okay, hold on a second now, because here's the bottom line. I'm gonna go with AJ on this one, okay? If you take one of the meat, you take the middle meat out. You take the third meat, the third year out. There's no championship that year. They're still trying to run fast. They're still trying to get a contract.
No doubt.
There's nothing changes. It's just you just got to meet at the end of the year where you're trying to win a medal. Okay, because those same tier people you're talking about. Are trying to get to the Diamond League final. They're trying to do something to make money. So what's the difference? Whether you're trying to run fast and win the world championships or trying to run fast, you're still trying to run fast.
The difference is, do the people directing their careers, both either on the day-to-day, meaning the coaches, or the management side, does your team know how to handle and prepare for this new reality? Because if they don't, the one that's going to suffer is the athlete. Coach is still going to make their money. The agent damn sure is still going to make their money. And the kid, they're going to move on to the next one after they done blown up somebody's career. We know this to be true. We see it all the time.
This is my question.
Okay, again, I'm not arguing any of that. I'm just saying the five-year championship role, it just happens to be 5 years in a row. Because there's no difference if there's four out of five. It's the same scenario.
What you got,
AJ?
This is my question. So, when you start looking at the numbers, you add that 1 year in, so there's no longer the quote unquote off year. How many? You don't have an off year. How many more high level races do you have to run in that championship year now? What are we talking? Two?
That totally depends on the athlete and their circumstance.
That totally depends.
No. On he's talking about required. How many are you required to run? How many do you choose to run? How many do you have to run? One.
And that's going to blow up somebody's career?
Well, two meets. The U.S. In a non-championship year, you don't have to go to USS unless your contract requires it. Half of them go there and they have to. But so if you take – so basically you're adding two meets to the equation when you add a championship. Because they're going to go to the same other meets that they're going to. Matter of fact, Alan, I'm sorry.
And two meets is going to blow up a career. I don't see that either.
If two meets is not remotely what I said, your career
was going to get blown up anyway.
That is not remotely what I said. I'm saying that the changes to our reality, our championship reality. First of all, let me be clear. I love the fact that I'm going to see five straight years of global championships. I'm all for it. I'm excited about it. But the fact of the matter is that we know that there are coaches in this game at the collegiate level, at the professional level, that don't respond well to sudden change. And they start to overthink things and they make crucial mistakes, but they're not the ones that have to go out there and run. And if you get a kid hurt because you came up with this different plan, you thought it was oh so different and required all these changes, athletes are going to suffer for it. We know it's going to happen. And I'm not rooting for it to happen, especially from the American perspective, because, you know, I want to see fast people run fast all the time. I'm just saying there's no way that you can have Lucius is saying, one extra year of championships isn't necessarily a big deal. And I get where he's coming from on that. Lamar's on the total opposite end. He says it's a, you know, seismic change and a huge deal. I think it's a huge deal depending on who the person is running the show.
This is what I'm going to say to you, okay? The people who – there's a small group of coaches that win medals every year, okay? We'll figure it out. I promise you that, okay? That group of coaches ain't blowing up nobody. I promise you that. That group of coaches, because it's the same six, seven people, well, we'll figure it out. I promise you that.
Okay. I'll say this. Lucius, you and I, we had a conversation about how this particular year, obviously pre-COVID, this particular year was going to be interesting to see how people dealt with the late World Championships followed by the early Olympics. Remember this conversation? Okay. Mm-hmm. So if you and I had a conversation and we both were on the same page thinking that that was going to be interesting, you're going to tell me that throwing in another championship coming off of a year of COVID of no races, that that's not going to be interesting and different, and that some people are going to completely blow that apart?
Okay. Any championship year is interesting, okay? Any year is interesting, but I don't see people getting blown up. I just don't know why we're using that analogy. I don't know why we think that's going to be an issue, because I don't see it happening. I believe, I've said this before, the people that can coach will coach. If there's a group of coaches, and I'm not going to start naming names, that I trust and believe in, they will have their athletes ready. I believe that, okay? And the thing about this whole thing about coming off a year of no racing, that's what makes it easier to go to five.
Because I don't disagree.
Okay? So nobody wants to talk about that, because now this is a year where people can rest, right? You know what? We've had like 10 weeks of people just chilling. Right.
I think the best.
So hopefully there'll be some races later this summer. There'll be two or three races for people, depending on who wants to go run. We don't get into that nonsense. But like, we're factoring in a rest and thinking being restful is going to be a problem. And I'm the rest is best for me. You know, that's what
I agree with you there. And I honestly think that the Olympics getting pushed back a year actually helps the United States a lot, because I think there was going to be a lot of people that had messed up the late Worlds, early Olympics. And because the Olympics were early, that was going to do some strange things as it pertains to the collegians.
You're going to have that same problem next year.
Yeah, we are going to have that same problem next year. But remember, there's a lot more time to plan. There's a lot more thought process that can go into that I don't think was going to go into it this year. I guess we'll never know.
I don't understand. What'd you say, Alan?
There's more unknown right now with this whole COVID situation. So yeah. it's more difficult to plan now because we're unsure of what's actually going to happen and not.
Exactly.
But
I agree with that. We don't even know if we're going to have people on campus in the fall to start fall training.
Yeah. But also going back to the 5-year, I think this is a great financial opportunity for individuals in the sport. And I think it's a great financial opportunity for the sport to get a 5-year run where we have the opportunity to have eyes on us every single year. Maybe this is something we can change and we can have a championship every single year so that we don't have the 3 years in a row where we have all these millions of eyes on us. And then we say, hey, man, we're going to take a break for a year. And then we're going to start back up and do it 3 years and take a break for a year.
Alan, to that point, mm-hmm. How would you assess your level of faith in the powers that be to properly capitalize on this opportunity?
This is what I think. I think that at the end of the day, this sport is going to survive, and people are going to find a way to continue to make money from this sport as they have been for the last however long. Is it going to be in the same format that it is now? Maybe, maybe not, but. There's too much money out there, and there's too much room for us to grow. And if we get the opportunity to be on TV, to have eyes on us every single year for 5 years in a row, you know, it's something different, something I think that we can look at and we can figure out, and because we have to do something to increase the amount of revenues in this thing.
I think if ever there was a time that there needed to be a North American circuit, that there could be a North American circuit, and that it could actually, like, work and be funded, it's now. There's too many justifications for it. There's too many people who are fans of not doing global travel that's not necessary. I think if ever there was a time to do it, it would be coming out of this whole COVID-19 thing. And I would definitely say if I was an agent and I was looking at any of the superstar track kids that were coming out next year, I wouldn't have them sign anything less than a 5-year deal with no reductions.
Good luck with that, bro. Good luck with that. And see now, and I'm on a side with my man Clyde on one thing. The second tier athlete is going to get punished in this because they're going to get punished. You know, because unless you find a way to find the meets, to find a way to run fast, like, you're not going to get opportunities. You're just not, because with it being 5 years in a row, in that off year or so when that second-tier athlete can sneak into a big meet, make a couple of dollars, that's going to go away because the lanes are going to continue to be filled by the major stars because the money's going to be there because it's always a championship year, which speaks back to what Lamar is saying. We do need to create. I mean, I just don't know, like, what happened to, like, the Olympic festivals and people, things like that, you know?
Exactly.
Like, you know, I have videos pop up on my timeline all the time of those meets, and there were great young talents in those meets, and there were, you know, established superstars in that meet as well, you know? You know, like a world record was running that meet, you know? So, like, we got to create stuff like that so we have opportunities for these guys and girls that are burgeoning stars that don't get a chance because they can't get a lane anywhere, you know?
It's difficult. I know when I was involved in USA Track and Field AAC, the athletes tried to put a meet on. It was a meet for the athletes by the athletes. And it was my job to call to try to get the athletes to come to the meet. You'd be surprised at the number of athletes that turned it down. I mean, it was, we were keeping everything. It was our meet. We were paying ourselves. We were keeping all the money. The meet was going to be in Eugene, Oregon. Athletes were like, nah, I'm not coming. So
I'm not shocked at all, sir. Not shocked at all.
Disappointed.
Y'all know,
disappointed.
Y'all heard me
thoroughly disappointed.
We talked about it 3 or 4 times of that. The athletes, until they figure out themselves and how to unify themselves, we're going to be having these same conversations.
Yeah. So,
yep. Well,
so I guess we have
no, go ahead.
5 years in a row.
We'll yep. have to see what we do with it.
Exactly, try to figure it out.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Well, Mr. Alan Johnson, thank you so much for all of your contributions tonight, and thank you for what you've done for our sport yourself. But we will bid you adieu, and we'll talk behind about your back a little bit. So you'll have to wait till later to see what we say.
Okay. Well, thanks for having me.
Thank you so yeah. much. Have a good
Appreciate
evening.
Appreciate you coming on, bro.
Thanks for coming, AJ.
Thanks, bro.
I'll see you later.
Bye. All right.
Well done.
There we go. All right, gentlemen. Now down to the nitty gritty. It's got our ears and about a couple hundred others. Let's start off with this one since we got rid of him first. Who's the greatest hurdler ever?
To me, body of work means something. He may not have the world record, but there's nothing else that he doesn't have. And to me, Alan Johnson was the best for the longest and the most consistent. I don't really feel that this is close. It's Alan Johnson.
Lucius?
I was going to say, who's disagreeing?
No, I mean, like, there's no way I'm disagreeing with that. I think that, I thought about this a lot today. And for me, there are parts to this. I think Nehemiah kind of reset the standard. You know, when he started running, the world record was 13.2, and he took it to 12.90-something. You think about Roger King, you know, back-to-back Olympic champion and the things that he did. And I think he set the world record at one point. You think about guys like Robles and Liu Chang. And, you know, one of my all-time favorite guys is Roger King, because he was fearless. But when you talk about a body of work, when you talk about a guy that showed up and did his job every single time at any and every level, and, you know, I've had conversations with him before, and, like, it was just his consistency. If he ran 13.2 or if he ran 12.9, he looked the same. He looked the same effort, the same consistency. And so, yes, no, he does not have the world record. I'm not even sure he's in the top five as far as times go. And I know a lot of people are going to want to say it's Aries, because Aries has the world record. Aries had one phenomenal year. So we want to talk about a guy that had the best year ever. It's Aries. But this is not about that. This is not that conversation. You know, in my opinion, Alan's the GOAT. And I have a hard time changing my mind on that one.
I'm struggling with this, because we're in rarefied air. The three of us never have done anything. But I look at it like this. I've tried for four days. To make a case for someone else, just to be contrary, you know, just because Alan is one of my best friends, and I can't. Like, look, maybe it's because I saw it, but I look at it like every measuring stick I use, like, he beat the most of the greats of anybody else. Like, he was in the absolute, like, glory period of hurdling, like the most guys that were under 13 seconds at once, like, in multiple races, and he never lost. Like, he won every world championship, every Olympics in his prime, and he raced everybody. Like, that dude would race Robles 87 times in a year if they'd let him. Like, you know, and we've been watching this Michael Jordan documentary, and every time they talk about MJ, I laugh, because, like, that's Alan Johnson. Like, Alan Johnson used to invent things about other hurdlers so he could not like them, so he could beat them. That's a fact. Right? And so it was like, look, trust me, I've been trying to have a different answer. Look, Ronaldo was phenomenal. He was like, it was almost like this incredible zenith that we got. The rest of his career got stolen from us because there wasn't enough money in the sport and he went to play football. Greg Foster was the epitome of consistency until Allen. Greg beat everybody. He didn't run under 13 seconds. Right. And for whatever reason, he won world championships like 98 million times, but didn't win the Olympics, right? What is wrong with me? Colin Jackson. I feel like Alan Johnson is, other than the world record, I feel like Alan Johnson had Colin Jackson's career, but longer. Like, beat everybody, raced everybody, beat them indoors, beat them outdoors, right? So Colin Jackson is definitely in that conversation because, like I said, he had the world record. But I just think when you look at all the pieces, like the fastest ever, the most consistent, I think we all agree he was the most consistent hurdler. But, like, the fastest, the most consistent, you know, race the most people, like, you know, all those things, like, it just keeps coming up, AJ. So I'm sorry to not be able to
Agree,
but on this one.
All right, so, okay, so since we are in such rarefied air, let me make it more interesting then. I'm going to hold my colleagues here. I want a top five. That we won't agree on. So give me a top five.
From one to
five? I'm not going first this time.
One to five. We all agree.
I'm not going first.
Three, four, or five.
All right, well, Clyde, put it out there. Let's go with yours first.
No. I came up with the question first. I'm throwing it to y'all first.
Okay, so I'm on Front Street. That's fine.
Yes you are.
Fine. Hey, look, have y'all ever seen my veins pump Kool-Aid? Absolutely not. So let's do it.
There's a first time for everything.
I'm going to say AJ's one. I'm actually going to say Skeets Nehemiah is two. Colin Jackson, three. Roger Kingdom, four, because I can't get past the two back-to-back Olympic gold medals. And then five is a hard one for me because now you're talking about world record holders versus consistency of Greg Foster. You know, this is not going to necessarily be a popular one, but I actually would like to say that it's Liu Zhang because he took on all comers and, you know, prior to injury, he was on his way to rewriting it all. So that's my five in order, and I'll stand by that.
Okay, so, you know, we've established AJ's the standard bearer. And then I'm going to go with Kingdom because of the back-to-back Olympic titles. And, you know, even though I think Ronaldo was – I know he was the game changer. Because he went away, that knocks him down the list for me. So I'm going to go with Colin third. And then – I'm going to go Liu Zhang. And then Skeets would be my fifth.
That's really, really interesting. Wow. We're not nearly as far off as I imagined that would be. I instinctually, I figured that one way or another, it was at least going to be a 2 out of 3 that we were going to agree that Allen was number one. So I was like, I got to throw him that question. And for many of the same reasons that you all have stated, I don't necessarily disagree with the group. I think we have the same group there. For me, you know, I'm obviously younger than you guys, but everybody, all the coaches I've ever dealt with at some point, be it high school, early college, everybody used to point to Ronaldo as, you know, the standard, right? And I totally understood that. And when I cared enough to study my sport and saw that he changed the game and took the records down, I totally get that point. But maybe it's me as a track purist. The fact that he left to pursue something else, that for me, that knocked him all the way down. That put him at five for me. And so for me, given his size, I was always just extremely impressed with Colin Jackson. But Roger Kingdom was always my favorite hurdler when I was growing up and just watching hurdles until I became more acutely aware of Allen. So for me, Kingdom was two, Jackson was three, Skeets was five, and four, for him to do what he did under the pressure that he was on, it has to be Liu Zhang at four for me. It has to be. Because
wasn't your list the same as mine?
I think it was.
All of us have the same five. Just the same five people.
That is really interesting. But I will never forget watching Liu Zhang under that pressure. Like, it's hard for me to even quantify for people and for the people that don't understand the nuances of politics and everything that he was facing. Like, that was an incredible, incredible feat that he pulled off. And so, yeah, that's, to me, I could not leave him out of my top five.
So I just want to stick this in there to Chuck's point. You cannot quantify what that looks like. And I was in Australia and I saw this very same thing happen before with Kathy.
Yep.
And Kathy, like, knowing that you are wearing the weight of an entire country, and in her case, not just a country, but an entire tribal, you know, completely disrespected portion of that country and all of its history, like, to wear that on top of the Olympics, it's like, hey, you're going to go to the Olympics and you're going to be blindfolded and we're going to put your hand, tie your hands behind your back, and we expect you to win. And so to watch that, you know, like, I couldn't agree with you more. Like, to win the Olympics as the, like, overwhelming favorite in your home country, that is just not easy.
And that country in particular.
I'll throw you guys a couple of guys that, like, I think that they have phenomenal careers and aren't talked about enough. And obviously, you mentioned Greg Foster already. You know, Greg was phenomenal. Yeah. But he only ran 13 flat, right? Only ran 13 right. flat. Right. Another guy that the Garcia guy from
Anir Garcia, from Cuba. Yeah. Cuba. Both of Mark. The Cubans. Robles as well.
Robles. Yeah, Robles as well. Mark from Mark, I can't remember his last name, from Canada.
Mark. Oh, Mark McCoy.
I can't remember his last name right now. But and then did I freeze? Can you guys still hear me?
You're good.
Yes, we can.
Okay. And then the other guy's Terrence Trammell. You know, Terrence had a long, illustrious career, and nobody knows because he never won the big one, but he was always around, you know, he was always around. So those are guys that were in the thick of things that don't get credit for what they did or how they did because of all the people we've already mentioned.
So. I think Terrence is just poor timing, because if yes. he wasn't head-to-head with Allen for all those years – I think it turns out, and people remember his time very, very differently. I've yeah. always been a huge
wrong,
fan.
Wrong, as people like to say, he had the wrong birthday.
Yeah, we used to play that game, like who had the worst birthday.
Yeah,
he's definitely in that conversation.
Now, Chu, if you would allow me, I'd like to throw one more question, but only to Lamar, because it wouldn't necessarily be fair for ask Lucius to answer.
Go for it.
Okay,
Lamar. Will Flamingo ever be top five all time?
You know, here's what's funny. It goes back. It ties back to something we were talking about earlier. If he wins all five of those, he might be number one.
Oh, no doubt. I mean, no doubt.
So what I'm saying is, part of it is like, look, he's got it out in front of him. That's not a pressure piece. I'm just saying, like, to answer your question, like, is he ever going to do it? I think he's going to be top five. I think he can get there. But there's a whole lot of winning that has to happen. You know what I mean? And so, like, in order to be top five, he's going to have to be some conglomeration of the five guys we talked about. He's going to have to deal with the mounting pressure of, I won already, so I'm wearing the champion's mantle. So that's a little bit of Liu Zhang. He's going to have to be super consistent like AJ was and take on all comers and not get hurt. He's going to have a little bit, of Colin Jackson and a couple of the others, like, because he's probably going to have to break the world record to do these things that we're talking about. So along the way, I think if he just focuses on – if he tries to win each year, so not try to win all five, but if he tries to win each year and he manages to medal in all five and break the world record, I think he probably is in the top five just from that.
I agree.
Well, so yes, I think he's got a very good chance. He's got a very good chance of being in there.
Well, I'm gonna ask Lucius to answer that question, because I think he is fair-minded enough to extract himself from the attachment as it is. You know, Lucius, what do we think?
Only Big Lee could ask that. I love it.
Let's go. I am so shocked that she asked me that question. No, I'm going to say this, that Does he have the skill set to do it? Absolutely. I think the big thing is the focus. Does that remain? Does he become a master of his craft? Will he continually do the work? Will he take care of his body? And as you know, Lamar said, we have to take it one year at a time. You know, because like I think that, and I've had these talks with Lamar and Clyde. I mean, I think that if I graded him on his races, like I graded him on his 1298 and I gave him a B-. You know, I graded him on his 735 and I gave him a C+. He thought I was crazy. Because in his 735, I'm going to win, you know. World championships, his semifinal run was much better than his final run. So if he continues to learn to be a better technician and to master the event, there's no doubt in my mind he has the potential to be one of the best ever. He does.
Got it. I like the answer. I like it.
And hopefully his coach won't mess him up.
You know, you never know nowadays. You
never know about that guy, right?
I have a hot off the presses. I asked that question of our illustrious guest, and he said, sure, I think he can get there.
There it is.
If AJ thinks he can get there, you know.
Yeah.
And I just want to say this for the record, if you're listening, Daniel Robertson,
Robert.
That's the man's name.
Yeah.
I have called that dude Daniel Robertson like 55 million times. I am sorry, Daniel. I am sorry. The point is, those same five meets exist for you too, sir. So,
absolutely.
Stay thirsty, my friend.
Look,
you too. Let me say this.
I know Daniel and I know his coach, Tim Hall, very well. Thirsty is not even a description for what they are. And you can best believe that Flamingo and I have the utmost respect for both of them, and we are not going to fall asleep at the wheel. That's for sure.
I think the presence of Roberts and the fact that they are so close in age makes this potentially just an epic 5-year battle. Because honestly, I see those two as heads and shoulders above the rest. And
it's Foster and Nehemiah all over again.
Yeah.
It's Foster and Nehemiah all over again.
Awesome. Well, as promised, thought-provoking, invigorating, mind-boggling, all these things we've accomplished in this evening. But thank you, gentlemen, as always, for your time, your thoughts, your ideas, and your comments, because we are spinning some wheels out there for sure. So other than that, we'll see you next week. We'll get some more thought-provoking things. We know things are happening day by day and week by week right now. So we'll have some great topics next week for you. Have a good night.
Good night, everybody.
Thank you. Don't call it a comeback.